I'm going to talk, of course, about the symphony number four, but in reality I should talk a little bit about my opera, Antigone, because that symphony was an orchestral symphony derived from my opera. All the basics, everything is coming from the opera. So maybe I should give you some information regarding my opera. Actually, I'd like to go a little bit back to the history, a little bit. The 5th century before BC was very, very important for ancient Greece, and I would say for the entire world, because at that time, Athens was supposed to be the leading city in Greece, sent someone to look all over the world how they governed other countries. They sent someone with the name Solon. So he went back and he brought all the material. And he found out that it wasn't really very good what he brought back. There were a lot of dictators all over the world, and they were killing each other. Things like we see a little bit today, actually. And they didn't like that in Athens, of course. There was some exception there, the Asia Minor, the cities like Miletus, Ephesus, and some others. The first philosophers appeared at that time, and they were quite good. And there was a woman, Aspasia, that she was very much in all these philosophers. To make the long story short, the leader of Athens, Pericles, went there, he met Aspasia, and he had an affair with her. She was his mistress, in other words. And he tried to bring her back to Athens. And he had some problems with the government there, but then accepted the fact. When Aspasia came to Athens, brought with her all the poets and the artists and everything, and from Miletus and Ephesus, all of these places. And we started at that time what we call the golden age of civilization. That's really what it's about. The uncle of Pericles, Clisthenes, is the first one who said all the citizens have to vote for the government, which is the beginning of democracy. And after his uncle, Pericles becoming the ruler of the Athens for quite a long time, under the advice of Aspasia for everything, she brought great artists, the greatest sculptor Phidias and some others to Athens, and they built Parthenon and all these acropolis that everybody goes to see. And we have three major philosophers at that time: Socrates, Plato, and for all the time there, and the playwrights, the arts are blossom, all the arts. And the major playwright is Sophocles, Euripides, and Aeschylus, three of them. And later on, Aristophanes, who wrote the comedies. Well, so we come to this situation, and I'm talking, my idea here is about Sophocles. And the poets and the playwrights, they took as a subject things they were not sure if they were real or it was a little bit legend, because people of the community, they know really the stories very well, and they were respond immediately. So my opera here is based on Sophocles' trilogy. It was the legend of Oedipus. Oedipus in Greek means feet that hurt, because he was walking you will see why in the wilderness at his feet were hurt, were wounded. That's his name. Okay. Now they had also the Delphi oracle that was telling the future to people. And people at that time, they used to believe to that. So there's a city northern of Athens, Thebes, that was quite powerful at that time. And they started having problems in the country. And anyway, the king of Thebes went to Delphi, asked them what was going to be the future. And Delphi told him, not a very good one for you, because your son is going to kill you. So that king went home, was very unhappy about that. And he got a son who was Oedipus. So he didn't want to make it clear to the city that he was going to exterminate his son. So he sent some of his army people, take the boy to the wilderness, and he's going to die there anyway. So it's like what they did, but when they went there, they felt a little bit sorry for the little boy. I mean, the soldiers, so they left him there. Some passengers came on one later. They found this baby there, they took him down to another city in Corinth, in Peloponnese, where there was a kid and his wife, they didn't have children. So they gave them the little boy. And the little boy was adopted by the new kings, and he was brought up really like a king himself, because he was the son of the rulers. Later on, it's important so you understand about the opera a little bit better. So later on, Oedipus, when he grew up, he went for hunting or something like that, and he met the king of Thebes, his father, in other words. They didn't know who was there. They kept him back, terrible quarter there, and he kills his father. He didn't vote, of course, no, of his father. That was very bad for the city, so they started to have him famine and everything else. In addition to that, there is a monster there, which you have seen in Egypt and other places, the so-called Sphinx, that he was terrorizing all the people who were coming to the city. And he got a riddle, and the riddle was, what's the creature that when it's young, walk with four legs, then grows two legs, and all three legs. And if you didn't answer the riddle, he was devouring. So, the city passed. Don't forget now, the ruler has been, he was dead. It was a wife only. And at that time, they should have the man as a ruler at that time. So the city passes an advertisement. The one who's going to be, to solve the riddle, is going to be the new king. So Oedipus was happy to be there, so he was there, and he said, well, it's the human. When the human is small, he walks with a four. When he grows up, he's two. And when he grows old, he has a stick, so he walks with three. So the Sphinx automatically was, he died, because the riddle was solved. And the second problem, that he's getting married his mother. And that's the beginning of the legend of Oedipus. He did not know that, because his mother, by the way. So he's becoming the king, he makes four children. Antigone, Ismene, two girls, Eteocles and Polyneikes. So that was a terrible thing to happen to, at that time, actually like it is now. Get married, your mother, and all these things. So who is suffering? The city. Famine, deaths, blah, 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 name it what happened. So Oedipus goes to the Delphi, say, what's wrong with my city? And Delphi tells him, it is you. You create all these problems, because you did all these murders. So this is the first tragedy by Sophocles. Oedipus the king, or as we say, Oedipus Tyrannos, or Rex Oedipus. Many artists have written many works on this. So the first one, when he knows that he's the reason, he exiles himself. His daughter Antigone takes him to a suburb of Athens, and he stays there until he dies forever. That's the first. That's actually the second play. The first was Oedipus Rex. The second is Oedipus in Kolonos. Kolonos was the place that he went to die. And that's the situation. So there were two boys there, Theocles and Polynices. So according to the law, the one takes over 1 year to be the king, and then the next year the brother takes over. So Theocles is the first year. He liked very much to be ruler, of course. We know about these things. So when the second year comes, he does not want to leave the rule to his brother, Polynices. Polynices is very unhappy about that. He goes out, she leaves, she goes to Peloponnese, another city there. He gets married with a princess there, and he's becoming a king of a city in another area in Greece. And he brings the army from there to come to Thebes to get the rule for himself. There's a big battle, and both brothers are killed at the battle, both Theocles and Polynices. So, at that time, really, my opera Antigone begins. What happens next in order is the uncle, Creon, who rules the city now, and Creon makes a rule that the one who fought with the army at he died bravely, like a Theocles, he should be buried with all the honors. The other one who brought other army to fight against his own city, he should be left alone to be eaten by the animals, not buried. That was very bad for the antiquity, because at that time they believed through the burial they could go to paradise or whatever. So at that point the opera starts, and this is the prologue of the opera, which is going to be the prologue of my symphony, that the two sisters are met. That's where it started, Antigone and Ismene. Antigone is the powerful one, Ismene is the weak one. So they talk about this, what happened, and Antigone tells her sister, we can't leave it like that. Both our brothers died. That's not up to Creon to decide who's going to be buried and that one not to be buried. They don't belong anymore to us, so we have to bury the other brother also as well. Meanwhile, Creon passed a big order. If anybody goes to bury the brother who brought the army against his city, he's going to be executed. So that's really the beginning. So the beginning of the play you are going to hear at my opera is that the two sisters, they meet in the a night somewhere, so they cannot be seen by the spies of the king. And that way, the story is passing between the two. Information, which is going to be my first mover, what we are hearing, what happened. The second is that Antigone said, I'm going to bury my brother, and Ismene does not go along with that. there. To make the long story short, Antigone buried her brother, but she was caught and was brought to prison. And that thing is my second image for the opera and my place here. They break Antigone with chains like that, and they put her and they bury her down to die out of starvation, whatever. Well, the problem is that the son of Priam, Emon, is in love with Antigone. And then start all the situation, which got to remind you, the famous Romeo and Juliet. Antigone is there, and Emon makes a tremendous fight with his father, tells him that what you do is wrong, and you think you know everything, but these people of the Thebes, they know that you're absolutely wrong. And this is another big spell of democracy, how one is not good enough to decide the future of the city. Meanwhile, Antigone is committing suicide in her grave, and when Emon goes to free her, he sees that already she died, so he kills himself. It's exactly the same like Romeo and Juliet, exactly the same. Then, it does stop very much there, because the gods did not like that either. So he goes out to start. The king loses his son. He loses his wife because his wife lost her son. He does not want to see him. The city is again in a big trouble, and he tried to correct himself, sending his servants to see if Antigone is still alive to free her, but it was too late. And the last act of this play is that he leaves himself and he talks how stupid he has been his life, that he did everything wrong, that he lost his family, he lost his son, he lost his wife. Nobody wants to see him in the city, and that's the end of the play. That opera, when I was in high school, was supposed to the last grade, we had to do the Homer, Iliad and Odyssey, and one of the operas. At that time, when I was in the last grade, the opera was Antigone, we played the Antigone there. And I was supposed to be the musician of the class, of course, at that time I had already a diploma from the conservatory. So at that time there was not really a composer of what to do. So what I did, I picked up music from Handel, Purcell, Vivaldi, etc., from the Baroque composer. But of course I fell in love with the play. And my high school was only for boys, so at that time, which was a stupid thing, the government did at that time, and he corrected that later. And but the director of the school, the principal, was always a literature man, usually one who taught ancient Greek. He brought two daughters, she has two daughters, he brought the two daughters, and the one did Antigone, the other, I mean, he brought a professional stage director, and we did that. Again, I thought to myself, one time I'm going to make an Antigone myself. So, to make the long story short, it took me about 20 years. Written here, bam, there, went to the theater to see translations, etc., etc. Until 1994, Dean here was, Cher was his name. He was a pianist, and at that time he was the violin teacher here. So we would play together trio. So he I thought that the dean that I want to do the opera, and he turned that to the faculty for the season. All the voice faculty turned it down. That was the beginning. The second one, I tried to make a grant application, the arts council. They turned it down there too. However, the director of the orchestra, the Lesue Symphony, was someone with the name Maiorara Trifan, conductor, a woman conductor from Romania, who later she went to Germany and she was professor at the Hochschule in Munich. So this one, of course, I had very good relationship with her, and she took it at heart. So it was difficult things to have an orchestra. I contact the orchestra, here I need the two choirs. The two choirs was Ken Fulton, was there, who's the husband of Lori Baytown, and another with the name Bert. And he saw control all the big the orchestra and the choirs. Also in the city, has brought someone with the name Arduino, you don't know the thing, so tell you about Baton Rouge now, who made an opera here in Baton Rouge. And this opera was quite a successful. At that time I was the concertmaster in Baton Rouge Symphony, and therefore I was the concertmaster of the orchestra of the opera Miss Arduino had. So I went there and told her my problem. She took at heart. All the women took at heart. All the men were against me. And I was very well with women always. That's true, but I'm very. And so, at that time also, I have become this title that I have as a boy professor. It comes with some money that. So I told Dean I can give them money, my money from the year before and this year after. And he said, fine, we will go ahead. So we will get to go ahead, and we made three performances here, two for the audience at the Union Theater and one for students. Three concerts completely packed. The university school just made a lot of money out of this. Okay, and this is the program you want to take a look. That we use, and it was the Baton Rouge Opera. It was the opera at that time that did not survive because they sabotaged the newcomer here. So they left. And the LSU Opera Theater together, they did that opera. Now, I come to my subject, and out of this, I made a CD which is this of the opera when we did it. What I did to write, to make the symphony and the opera, it is to put in the opera to make it various chapters. For instance, this first chapter at the beginning, which I call prologue, it is the formation between the two sisters. Then the second chapter is that there is a battle, and the battle, the brats are killed, and that the one goes to do the penny herself, and she's caught. Then the third battle is the famous chorus of Sophocles, love who's always winner. It was when Amon goes give it to his father, how horrible he is. Then the next one is when they bring Antigone. And then there is the chorus. The chorus was 15 people. And the servant is the head of the chorus, which is really like the Senate today. Senators and the head of the Senate. They advise the king always for what's happening. And then it's the same thing, goes and tells him, you are doing wrong, they told to the you're not doing well, and the gods are not very happy about that. So this is my next chapter here in my symphony. In fact, I have, out of this opera, I made two symphonies, symphony number 3 and symphony number 4. And that is what I'm talking today. And I have a performance of the of my symphony, which you're going to hear from the Kiev Philharmonic in Ukraine. By the way, that was played also on September 29th in Romania. That symphony was played by the Constanta Symphony Orchestra. So I had a lot of ways to present this. So this one is in 7 parts: parodos, odes, interlude, ode, pear, when the gods are in death care, a lament of Creon, is the last one that Creon is gone out of the city, completely unhappy, and Sophocles is very hard on him. That's really what is there. Generally speaking, in the plays, you have the episodes and the choruses. Always in the Greek plays, the episodes, they give you the action, what's happening. The choruses is always comment. The chorus makes comment. And of course, usually the choruses are the best work, because the description, the Sophocles talks about nature, about the gods, about this, about that. That's what it is, and that what it is in my piece here. And here I had the parados, the old one, interlude, and exactly what I told you about before. In the two last parts of my symphony here, I use vocal, and I use also words from the Sophocles work. The one is when the gods come down to help the pair, and I have a soprano for this we are going to hear. And the last one, I have the lament of Creon. This is when Creon is very, very unhappy, and you more or less feel sorry for him that he has been so stupid in his life. Speaking about how I compose, and most of you have been my students, and more or less you know how I teach you for that. But I use for my own composition. I use a lot of motive variation, but it's a lot of climaxes and poses. I keep that word painting. I used a lot of designs, and in a manner like Brahms, Wagner, and early Schoenberg, that was really stylistic. And then I put a motif, a light motif for every character. For the characters of Antigone, there's motif. There's a motif for the Ismenes. There's a motif for Creon. There's a motive for the unhappiness of the city. I put motives before even I started composing that piece at all. Then, of course, I will work them together and start really easy to find it. Also, you're going to hear the first part. I bring all the motives at the very, very beginning, so you can see what you're going to hear for the rest of the piece. And I think the best for me is to play the piece and go closer so you can have to see the score. Be in a place that you can see a score. I put 5 scores there. You have to look at the score, otherwise you're not going to understand.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. the wood block.
I did contact that, by the way. So it's good. You do like something, I would not support. I don't know what you have to give specifics.
No, I'm talking about the wood block.
Yeah.
And you are like, all the movements has a wood block in the, at the end.
Yeah, because this is the connective tissue.
Okay.
The that piece. It's not only here, it's in the opera too.
Oh, okay.
That's actually, it's the, that is the motif of the fate.
The wood block.
That's the motif of the fate. That is, that's, he didn't do anything wrong. He didn't, it's how it happened. That was a connective tissue.
Okay.
Okay, thank you for coming, and let me have my scores and then.